good to see everybody here. I missed being here last Sunday. I was in bed with a sore mouth. But I tell you what, not being here on a Sunday really throws your entire week off. And I had fall break too, so Wednesday felt like Monday. Everything was just all out of whack. But it's so good to see all of you here. If you'll all stand and join me, we'll sing Old Church Choir.
There's revival, and it's spreading like a wildfire in my heart. A Sunday morning, hallelujah, and it's lasting all week long. Can you hear it? Can you feel it?
We'll let Mr. Whaley be scoot on by. Alrighty. Has anybody had a birthday since last Sunday? Or today?
How about you?
Has anybody had an anniversary since last Sunday? No anniversaries. All right, now on to our announcements. Our pantry items for October are Piggly Wiggly gift cards to purchase turkeys for Thanksgiving, hair care supplies, toothpaste, and toothbrushes.
The
gift cards. If you want to get the Piggly gift cards, you can. If not, then you can give me the money, and I will go and put it all on one card so it's easy for them to shop instead of, you know, paying with 37-Eleven gift cards. But whatever floats your boat. Hair care supplies, like toothpaste, toothbrushes, I think they're good on that for right now. Okay. They have a list on their page on Facebook that has more items that they actually need right now instead of this. But, yes, gift cards. And they're also starting to take stuff for Christmas cheer as well.
Okay.
They said for the, it's the normal toy thing for ages 3 to 10 or 11, I believe. After that age, if you want to do things for teens, they're asking for gift cards because they're harder to buy for, and it's easier to give them a gift card to like McDonald's or somewhere like that, something they can actually use.
All right. Sounds good. And there will be no children's church today, but here are jobs for children's church for the remainder of the month. October is flying by. Yay. No, not yay. All right, and we will not be having evening worship service tonight. And then Christmas play practice every Tuesday evening. That will be at 7 p.m. And for cast and choir, anybody that would like to join the choir or cast, if there's anything that you would like to do, be a part of, show up. Then Wednesday night, we'll be doing our Make a Joyful Noise, and if you would like to join us, please meet here at the church at 6:30. And then this upcoming Saturday is the Special Needs Baseball game at the Albertson Baseball Field. So if you signed up, please go. If you didn't, please go. It's so much fun, y'all. And then there will be a youth outing after the ball game for anyone who wants to join us. So meet at Hog Wild at Howard Farms in Jacksonville at 2 p.m. So that'll be a lot of fun too. And then next Sunday will be our meetings. Deacons meeting starting at 4, Sunday School Council at 5, and quarterly meeting at 6. And then Sunday, October 30th. Your University of Mount Olive donation envelopes are due, and our goal is $4,200. So, if you've brought in your money already, shake out your couch cushions, find some more. If you haven't brought in your envelopes, that last Sunday is your day to bring it in. Sounds good. Bring it in to Miss C or Miss Maxine. And it's so good to have Miss Maxine back with us. I bet. Are there any other announcements? If not, if you'll all stand and join us and turn your hymn books to page 281, we'll sing When We All Get to Heaven.
Oh, my God.
It is now prayer time in our service. Are there any names that need to be mentioned at this time?
Philip Mercer.
Philip Mercer.
The Gardner family, Michelle Gardner passed away this week. I've known her for quite some time, so if you could keep their family in the prayers.
The Gardner family. Yes, ma'am. The Stephen Taylor family. Yes, sir.
Jesse Futrell.
Jesse Futrell.
Yes. Can you remember Elaine? She was going for her procedure Tuesday.
Elaine Shepherd. Yes.
She tried really hard this morning, and she just couldn't.
Miss Irene. Yes, ma'am.
I have a praise. After almost 4 months, David went through Dr. Fine.
Amen.
Awesome. Young, praise the Lord. He's almost 2 feet.
Awesome. Pray for my mom. She thought she could walk down the stairs in the garage and she fell.
Oh.
But she, Lord was with all. She got her some scrapes and bruises.
She's tough.
Yeah, she's stubborn. She's stubborn. That's what it was.
I know a lot of people have been no comment. James Mills.
He's had surgery in the morning on his lower spine.
All right.
And we're not sure really what we're expecting.
All right. Yes, ma'am.
Joanne Williams.
Yes, ma'am.
Continue to remember Daddy and one of my co-workers. She had a miscarriage.
Mr. Lamont and then one of Ms. Jennifer Whaley's co-workers.
Two or three really good days lately,
and he
texted
me just before service started and said, if things continue like they are, he might come home tomorrow.
Amen.
Yay. Are there any other prayer requests?
Miss Grace.
Miss Grace. That's Miss Grace. Any others? If not, raise of hands for silent requests. And Mr. Jeff.
Man, this is a good looking crowd out here this morning.
Amen.
I'm tell you what, it looks real good out here today. We've got one more to add. Keep Brother John Keffer in your prayers. He fell trying to go fishing the other day and broke his hip. Had to have hip surgery, replacement surgery. And he's supposedly doing pretty good. Had to do some rehab and stuff like that. But just keep him in your prayers. And just remember to pray for each other, yo. We pray for each other. I'll spit it out in a minute. My tongue is all tied this morning. It's fine. But let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this beautiful day that you've given to us, Father. We thank you for allowing us to come into your house this morning and to sing praises to your name and to fellowship and just to be in your presence, Father, just to be in the presence of the Holy Spirit. Lord, you've heard all these names that have been mentioned this morning. You've seen all the hands raised. You've seen all, you know, all the things that are on our hearts, Father, all the needs that we have. And Father, just be with all of those that we've mentioned this morning, all the ones who are bereaved now, the ones who are sick and suffering, the ones that just need that special touch from you, Father. Lord, we pray especially for those who do not know you as their Savior. Those are the ones who are the most lost and the most in need of our prayers, Father. We ask that maybe today will be the day of salvation, that they will understand and they will come to truly know who you are and what you can do for them, what you have already done for them, but they may not know it. Lord, just be with us all now. Be with us throughout the rest of this service. Lift up Pastor Ronnie. Give him the strength he needs to get out of that hospital and be back in the pews with us. Be back behind this pulpit, Father. That's where he wants to be. Father, just be with us all now. In Jesus' most precious holy name we pray. And all of God's children said, amen.
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 All right. If you'll stand and join us once again, the words for victory in Jesus will be on the screen.
Glory, how the Savior came from glory, how he
It is now time for our tithes and offerings. Would our ushers please come forward? Mr. Bobby, would you please bless our offering?
Our Heavenly Father, as we push our throne of grace this morning, Lord, we thank you for the many wonderful blessings that you've given to us. We come up at this time, Lord, to give back a portion of that which you have given to us. We ask, Lord, that you would use it to spread the gospel and the uplift of our name and to every call that you would enjoy. And Father, we thank you for all those wonderful blessings. We ask for blessings upon this offering. And Lord, we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
This is our turn. Come on up here, my wife. I roped her into doing one with me, so we're blessed to be here. We got enough air. We'll be all right. We'll be fine. This song, Lights of Home, the first time I heard it was only just a couple months ago. And it was sang by a group called the Horn Family. But they spelled their name wrong. They didn't have an E on the end of it. But it's a beautiful song, and I've told Stacy right after I heard it, I said, we got to try to figure this song out. And, you know, I wanted originally for the four of us, you know, me and Drew and Danielle and Stacy to do it. But we kind of at the last second this week, what was it, Wednesday, said, I want to sing this song for homecoming. She was like, she hates it when I do that. And I do that every once in a while, kind of spring some stuff on her at last minute. But I said, we can do it. We don't need, you know, Andrew and Danielle can come in later. We'll figure it out. But
because the Horns are two brothers and their wives.
Yeah, that group that sings this is two brothers and their wives, so it kind of, you know, kind of fits. But we really enjoyed this song. I hope we can do it justice. So y'all, it takes a lot of air, so y'all just pray for us.
John tells of a city that he saw coming down, where no pain or death will be known. And someday we can go there through God's marvelous grace, forever live in that heavenly home. I can almost see the lights of of that city, I can see them gathering all around that great white throne. Through faith in my Savior and his wonderful love, well, I can almost see the lights of home. Sometimes I am burdened and my cross seems hard to bear, and old Satan, he tries to dim my view, but I'll just look up to Jesus. He is standing close by, and once again his great light shines through. I can almost see the lights of that city. I can see them gathering all around that great white throne. Through faith in my Savior and his wonderful love, well, I can almost see the lights of home. Through faith in my Savior and his wonderful love, well, I can almost see the lights of home.
Ours takes a lot of air too, but not like that. A lot of hot air.
I want a story.
A story? You want me to tell you a story?
Yeah.
Okay. One day a rich man took his son to see how poor people live.
Oh boy, a real story.
A real one, yes. They drove way out into the country to visit farm workers. To the father, the family was poor. They lived in a small home that the creek flooded every time it rained. They had no porch or patio or any place to sit at night. They worked hard for the little bit they had.
Oh wow, that's too bad.
On the way home, the father asked his son what he learned during the trip.
What did the son say?
He said, I learned that we have one dog and they have four.
Yeah, that's cool. Four doggies, wow.
And the son said, we have a pool that stops in our backyard and they have a creek that has no end. We have electric lanterns in our garden and they have the stars. Our patio ends at the front yard and their front yard reaches the horizon. We live on a small piece of land and they are in the middle of many fields.
Wait a minute, I thought you said they were poor.
Oh, I'm not done yet. The son said, I see they grow their own food and we buy ours. We see we have a fence around our house for protection and they have friends around theirs.
This story is not what I thought it was gonna be.
Maybe not, Annie. The father looked at his son. The son said, thanks, Dad, for showing me how poor we really are.
Wow. I guess he showed his dad how unimportant things like swimming pools and big houses really are.
Yes, Annie. The dad forgot how beautiful the things of nature are. Pools and houses are nice, but they can't take the place of kindness, friendship, and love.
Yeah, I guess you're right. Swimming pools are nice, but you can't fish in them.
Well. That's right, Annie. It depends on how you see things. Sometimes we take the things we have for granted. We may be rich in things, but poor in spirit.
Maybe we should just be grateful for what we have and remember to thank God every day for everything that we have.
I think that's a good idea, Annie.
Yeah. You know what? We should be joyful and appreciate everything God has given us. But I sure wish God would give me another puppy.
We are not having another dog at our house. I was like, this story is about me. We have four puppies at our house. We do not need another one. So, no, because God has given us all that we need. Right? And that's, amen, right? And that's what God is trying to tell us, right? Possessions aren't everything. Not even a fifth dog. But the love in our heart is where Jesus wants us to be, right? So it doesn't matter whether we're rich or poor. Some of the poorest people in the whole world are rich in spirit. And they care about nothing at all. They don't have a care in the world because God has taken care of them, right? Some of the people I know that have most of the money in the world have most of the problems because they've lost their faith. True that, right? And I know you keep looking at me wanting that fifth dog. It's not going to happen. But if you pray about it, everything will be good, I'm sure, right? You'll make a way. Your fifth dog will come when you have your own house and your own creek. Okay, but that's what we want to do, right? So never forget that every blessing that we have, that includes the ones that our mommies and daddies have, are a gift of God. And they'll say, well, my daddy works for his. Yes, and God gave him the tools and the knowledge, and mommy and daddy the tools and the knowledge to be able to do the work that we do. Mm-hmm. Everything that we do is a miracle of God. That's right. And we do it in his favor. And that includes the way y'all are in school. Yes. Right? You're excited. She's like, really? Yes. Everything that we do, whether you can fly a kite or you can ride a bike with no hands, and I do not condone that at all. But those are all gifts of God. A public service announcement, don't get me in trouble at home. So today we're going to get to hear Mr. Jody give us some sweet lessons from the Lord so he can carry us on throughout the week, right? And fight the good fight. Are y'all kids ready to hear it? Yeah. I'll take that as a yes. Yeah. All right. Sorry.
Ronnie and I have been in conversation quite a bit this week. We're supposed to have a baptism today, and without his presence here, we're not going to have a baptism, but we are going to have a baby dedication. I told him I really wish he was here so he could do it, but that's okay. I'm going to do it, and I'm very proud to do this one because this is a part of my family. Amen. And the Lord has strange ways of bringing people together through work, through marriages, through divorces, through whatever case it may be. But this family is very special to me this morning. So I want to look at what Ronnie, thank goodness Ronnie printed it out for me. So we're good at that. But today we are dedicating Maverick to the Lord. And it says, God delights in children. He takes great treasure and pleasure in them. They are one of the greatest gifts he gives to parents. Psalms 127:3 proclaims that, lo, children are an inheritance of the Lord, and the fruit of the womb is his reward. Because children are a gift from God, it is natural that Christian parents present, and dedicate their child to God. In the Gospels, we read that people brought little children and babies to Jesus so that he might place his hands on them and pray for them. In the same way, and I'm asking Morgan to come on up with Maverick, And I'm asking her immediate family to come on up. And I think she's asked some others to come that have been special to her and her family during her life. If he sleeps, it'll be fine. In the same way, Morgan today brings her son Maverick, presenting first herself and then Maverick before the Lord our God. Morgan, I call your attention to the commands of God recorded in Holy Scripture. In Deuteronomy 6, 4 through 7, it tells us, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart and with all thy soul, and with all thy might. And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart, and thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thy house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up." Years ago, the music group Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young had a hit song with the words, "Teach your children well." Indeed, there is no higher calling for we as parents. Proverbs 10:1 reminds us that a wise son brings joy to his father, but a foolish son grief to his mother. The best thing moms can teach their children is the fear of the Lord. For Proverbs 1:7 tells us this is the beginning of knowledge. This means that for a child to successfully apply all they learn in life depends on first learning to fear and follow God every step of the way. So the church urges you, Morgan, to love God with every ounce and fiber of your being and teach Maverick to do the same. As you love God, you will model before Maverick a wonderful love for God that he will want for himself. We're good.
Yeah, I will.
Morgan, by coming forward before God and his people, do you hereby declare your desire to dedicate yourself and Maverick to the Lord? If so, please respond by saying, "I do."
I do. Praise the
Lord. Having come freely, I ask you now that you enter into the following commitment in the presence of God and his people here assembled in this church. So that Maverick may walk in the abundant life that Christ offers, do you, Morgan, vow by God's help and in partnership with this church and others to provide Maverick a Christian home of love and peace, to raise him in the truth of our Lord's instruction and discipline, and to encourage him to one day trust Jesus Christ as his Savior and Lord?
I do.
For encouragement in fulfilling these words, Morgan calls upon her grandparents and others that have been instrumental in her life. Proverbs 17:6 declares how grandchildren are the crown of the aged. There is great pride in seeing a new generation of family and how that joy is reinforced when children are raised to fear God. To this end, I ask you the following questions. By coming forward before God and his people, do you hereby declare your desire to help Morgan fulfill the vow she has just made? If so, please respond by saying, "We do."
We do.
Having come freely, I ask now that you enter into the following commitment so that Maverick may walk in the abundant life that Christ offers. Do you vow by God's help to pray for and encourage Morgan in her effort to raise Maverick in the fear of the Lord so that he might receive our Lord's guidance and instruction?
We do.
Finally, I ask that the church make a vow as well. As believers in the body of Christ, we have a responsibility to teach the gospel story to our younger generation. In fact, the Old Testament prophet Joel commands us to tell of God's work to your children and let your children tell it to their children and their children to the next generation. And that comes from 1:3. Being present in God's house today, do you hereby declare yourselves to be the children of God because you trust in Jesus Christ alone for the forgiveness of sins and the gift of eternal life? Is this true? I ask you to please respond by saying, "We do."
We do.
Thank you. Would you please stand? Having come freely, I ask now that you make the following commitment before God and those who stand before you, so that Maverick may walk in the abundant life that Christ offers. Do you vow, by God's help, to be faithful in your calling as a member of the body of Christ, to help Morgan be faithful to God, and to help teach and train Maverick in the ways of the Lord, so that he might one day trust him as Savior and Lord? If you accept this responsibility, please respond by saying, we do.
We do.
Amen. Now I'm supposed to take the child.
Hey, buddy.
Been a while. Okay, let us pray. Father, we do thank you for this child that has been given to us. We thank you for the blessings that he has bestowed upon this family standing here and this church standing here today. We dedicate his life to you, and we hope that we can fulfill that dedication of service to you, that he will become a child of yours. We pray you be in his life from here and henceforth. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
And we also have a certificate of dedication, and the church also gives you a small token of our love for you and Maverick, a little Bible that hopefully he can start learning from. All right. Thank you. Thank you, guys. Good morning.
Good morning.
Man, I said it before and I'll say it again. It is good to see this many people in this church. Y'all need to come back every Sunday. Why can't y'all do this every Sunday? Huh? No, it is good. It's good to be here. Homecoming 2022. If y'all remember last year, this time, it was my first time preaching in front of an actual audience. I'd done it a couple times on camera, it was my first time actually preaching a sermon in front of a group of people, and it was a journey that I've started down, and I have not regretted not one step of it. I'm not going to tell you a story this time. I'll tell you several stories probably, but I'm going to give you some background on this sermon title, Are You Hungry? I'm going to reference this past Wednesday night's Bible study probably 4 or 5 times throughout this sermon. The Lord was speaking to me that Wednesday night. He has laid a lot of stuff down on me ever since then, from the conversations and the stuff that went on that Wednesday night. So I'm going to talk about it a few times. But we got off topic a little bit Wednesday night, as we often do, because we tend to have two-way conversations with whoever's up here delivering the little bit of information, the study that we're going on, and then the crowd will start asking questions, and we just have a good conversation all the way around. We got off a little bit off topic talking about how God speaks to us, when God speaks to us, how do we know when God is speaking to us. And I think it was Mom brought up, sometimes speaks to you whenever you're busy, when you're preoccupied with something else. You're focused on this task over here, unrelated to what he wants you to do. And that's what happened to me Wednesday night when I got home. I was doing schoolwork, and I was sitting there trying to read this passage out of a book that we were going over in class, and I could not focus on it to save my life. I could not focus on the word. I read this one paragraph over and over and over again like 4 or 5 times. Couldn't get focused on it. And I kept hearing this phrase, catching these little glimpses, these flashes of things popping into my head about homecoming. Because I knew I was, it was coming up, and I had to get a sermon prepared, and I was going to do my schoolwork Wednesday night, and then Thursday night and Friday night work on getting my sermon. Well, no, God had a different idea, as he normally does. I kept seeing these flashes and flashes about homecoming and hunger and these different pieces and parts. And so finally, I just put my schoolwork down, and I said, okay, what are you trying to tell me? Because something's going on here. I don't know what this is, but I need you to, I knew what it was. But I kept seeing, are you hungry? I kept hearing that phrase, are you hungry?
coming up in my brain. And first of all, I thought it was funny because it's homecoming, and yes, we all are hungry. I'm about to starve right now, ready to get all that good food that's back there in the back. But that's not the kind of hunger I'm talking about, not really. Have y'all ever been hungry? Have y'all ever really been hungry? And I say hungry, I'm not talking about, 12:01 on a Sunday morning, waiting for the preacher to quit talking so we can go eat hungry. I'm talking about really hungry, like haven't eaten in probably a couple of days. You got the shakes, you got, you can't focus on anything. Your brain is just all over the map. All you can think about is food. All you can think about is quenching that thirst, getting something on your belly. Some of us probably have. If anybody in the military has been out in the field for more than about 2 months, you probably figured out what hungry really is. But I don't think anybody in here, maybe you have, I don't think anybody in here has really been that kind of hungry. Hunger is defined as a feeling of discomfort or weakness caused by lack of food, coupled with the desire to eat. So yeah, when we're hungry, we're going to search for something to eat. But it's a desire for sustenance, something to keep us going, keep us moving, keep us going forward, keep us healthy. An internal yearning for something that we don't have, but that we know we need. So we know we need food. We know we need sustenance to keep us moving, to keep us going. And that's kind of what I want to talk about this morning is hunger. Trying to quench that desire we have for something that is missing in our lives. Searching for that peace that's missing from our hearts. We can always feel when we need something to fill us up spiritually. That's what I'm talking about. We all have that hollow space inside of us. And how many times do we try to fill that hollow space with something worldly, something we shouldn't do? A lot more often than we probably will admit most of the time. But this morning I'm going to tell you that there is something you can fill up with, something that you can fill that empty space in your heart, something that can sustain you for the rest of your life and beyond, beyond this life. Now, I was always told when I was younger I had a hollow leg. Anybody ever hear that before? Anybody ever told me that before? Yeah. Point one right there in the back, right there. She's told me that several times. Well, yeah, a lot of us are like that when we're growing up. Grown boys and sometimes grown girls, they just eat. They all eat all the time. I can tell you that right there. I'm going to have to take up a love offering after this so we pay the grocery bills. But, no, he's not that bad. But we all have a hollow heart. We all have a negative space in us. And, we have a hard time filling that with the right things. But I'm going to tell you what Jesus said over in John 6 and 35. He said, Jesus said, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall never thirst. And may God add a blessing to his word this morning. The bread of life. Jesus is that bread of life. He is that thing that can sustain us throughout all of our trials, all of our tribulations, all the things that we go through. No matter what, Jesus is the one that's going to get us through those times. Because he tells us that over and over again. But that verse there, Jesus had just finished feeding the 5,000 with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. Can you imagine? I want you to get yourself in that mindset. Go back 2,000 years and put yourself on the edge of the sea there where he's just fixing to sit down and feed 5,000 people plus with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. The disciples are like, man, this guy's crazy. He ain't never going to be able to do this. And the crowd is going like, yeah, this guy, he's going to run out of food real fast. But you know what happened? God showed up. God showed up. And when they got done feeding everybody, they carried off, 12 baskets of leftovers? 12 baskets of five loaves and 2 fish. Now, I know God still does miracles these days. I know he does that. But unless he intercedes today, I don't think that there's going to be 12 baskets of anything left over in the back tonight. Because that was before. See, this all happened. This John 6:35 happened before the Baptist showed up. Okay? We're not going to take anything. We're not going to leave anything behind. It's all going to go with us. But, Brian, did we have something like that happen a while back, didn't we? We had a miracle just like that. Wasn't quite as extravagant as that, but we had a small little God sighting, a small little miracle that happened in our church one night. What was it, beans? Was it Beans? We had a dinner here one night. I can't remember what it was for exactly. Was it a play or something? And we had a pot of beans back there, and Brian was digging beans out as hard as he could, feeding these people, and they kept coming. And he was like, I don't think we're going to have enough. He said, I don't think we're going to have enough beans for everybody. But guess what? Even though you looked at the bottom of that pot and there was only about three or four left, every time he pulled that ladle out, there was beans in there. God provided those beans for us that night. I mean, it may seem silly, but I mean, that happened. That's a legitimate miracle here. I believe that. That's exactly how God is with us today. When we're scraping the bottom of the barrel, we're scraping the bottom of that pot, God keeps filling that ladle up, filling that bowl up. Every time we go in there to scoop, there's something else in there to fill us up. God does that every day for us. And if you don't see that, we're going to have a talk afterwards. We need to have a conversation after this sermon's over with, because I'm telling you what, if you're not seeing what God does for you every single day, you are missing everything. We have to be hungry for God because He's the only one that can fill us up. I want us to look this morning at three ways we can work. Three things to be hungry for. Three things we need to be hungry for when it comes to God. Number one is we need to be hungry for God's Word. 1 Peter 2:2, reading from the NASB version translation. And like newborn babies, long for the pure milk of the Word, so that by it you may grow in respect to salvation. Long for the pure milk of the Word. So that's how our spiritual growth is. Spiritual growth is always marked by a craving, a desire for God's Word, God's truth. It's like Maverick. When Maverick's hungry and you give him that bottle of milk, he ain't letting go until it's gone. And sometimes you got to pry it out of his hands even when he's just sucking air. That's how we're supposed to be when it comes to God's Word, when it comes to God's truth. We have to be that hungry for it. And I know I'll be the first one to admit I'm not always that hungry for it. Sometimes I don't want to do it. I know we're all the same way, but that is how we should be. That's what we should strive to be. Strive to be that hungry. Because when we get into God's Word, we remember three things. We remember remembering our life's source, where our life comes from, eliminating sin from our lives, and admitting our need for God's truth. Those are the three things we can gather from there. We dig into God's Word. Because God's truth comes from only one place, the Bible. That's the only place it comes from. Psalms 119:11 says, I have stored up your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. We have to study. We have to get in it. We have to look at it. We can't just open the Bible up and say, all right, I'm just going to read this passage right here and say, all right, I'm good, and then move on. No, you have to look at each individual word. Look at the phrases. Look at the context before and after. What comes before and after that verse? You have to study. That's what studying is. You don't just open and read one thing and say, all right, I'm good, and walk away. You're never going to get anything out of it. We have to commit that stuff to our hearts. That's where our sustaining power from God comes from. It comes from His Word. There's nothing else like it. There's nothing else that we'll find on this earth that will fill us up like getting into God's Word and studying it. Or filling our spiritual stomach, so to speak. When we dig into God's Word, we get a glimpse of what God's plan is for us. We get to see what his plan is, how He's thinking, where His headspace is. What is He talking about? Because He speaks to us through His Word. He shows us His love. We get to see who He truly is. Who He truly is. And we learn about Jesus when we get into the New Testament. About who He was, who He is still. What He's trying to teach us, which leads to my next point. Number two, we need to be hungry for service. We have to want to help and serve other people. We get that. That's where we get that yearning for service through God's Word, because God tells us all the time. He tells us over here in 1 Peter 4:10, as each has received a gift, use it to serve one another as God's steward, as good stewards of God's varied grace. We all have individual talents and gifts that God has given us. We got to use them. If you get a gift, you don't use it, what's God going to do? He's going to take it from you, more than likely. And it's probably not going to be nice. But we don't get to choose what gift we get. I didn't specifically want to do this. When I felt the call, I was like, are you sure you want me to do that? Are you sure you want me to stand up in front of people and tell them about God Sunday after Sunday and, you know, all the time and all the stuff that comes along with that? And he said, yeah, I sure do. I said, okay. But we talked about Wednesday night about getting out of our comfort zone and how Victor is the best person in this church to get you out of your comfort zone. Besides God himself, Victor is the next in line of getting you out of your comfort zone. You ain't got to raise your hand, but how many of you has been talked into something by Victor? And then he ain't got, oh man, they said, they raised their hand. Man, they called you right out. But that's how we grow. That's how we grow. When we're pushed out of our comfort zone, that's how we grow, right? If you're not doing anything new, you're not going to learn anything new. Come on. You can agree with that. I know some of us don't like to get out of our comfort zone. That's fine. You'll get pushed out of your comfort zone eventually. But service. Back to service. Service, Jody. Service. But God's gift can only be received. It can't be bought, purchased, pursued, looked after, worked after. You have to get it from God. He gives it to you freely. But when we start feeding on God's word, we can see the many commands of service from God. Jesus is the greatest example of being a servant to others. Amen? He is the greatest example of being a servant. As much as he did for other people, you don't have to look anywhere else for him. Jesus tells us over in Matthew 20, 26 through 28, but whoever will be great among you must be your servant, and whoever will be first among you must be your slave. Even as the Son of Man came, not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. The ultimate sacrifice, the ultimate act of service was Jesus Christ. That's our measuring stick. That's what we should be looking at. We all fall short. Oh, me. I know I do all the time. And, you know, I mean, we can only do so much a lot of times, but a lot of times our restriction is us. It's not anybody else. We are our own parking brake, so to speak. But that's our sole purpose. One of our sole purposes as a Christian is service, to serve others. So if you truly are saved, if you truly are a Christian, you believe in Jesus Christ, you believe that he died for your sins, and you believe that he was a servant for other people, you should want to serve others. It shouldn't be a matter of somebody asking you, like, hey, Brother Willoughby, do you mind helping out with this stuff? Hey, I got you. Let's go. Let's do it. I'd love to see Brother Willoughby jump up right now and run around and try to help somebody else. I believe he tried to do it. I think Miss Sharon would be like, please don't do that. But we should have that yearning, that desire, that hunger to help other people. That's our whole thing as Christians. That's one of the first things on the list is helping and serving others. Because when you don't have that need, that desire, you're missing a lot of what God's offering and what God's blessings are for you. I said Wednesday night in Bible study that a closed hand misses two blessings. When your hand is closed and you don't give someone something, you don't help someone with something, you miss the blessing of helping that person. It's not a selfish blessing, but you will get something returned back to you. So if your hand is closed, you can't give someone a blessing. And you cannot get the blessing that God is going to give you back when somebody goes to help you. I've learned that over the course of the last few years. And I've learned that helping others, no matter how big or small it is, it doesn't have to be something great. You don't have to give somebody a house or any kind of crazy stuff like that. Just help somebody out. Give them a little bit of your time. We'll do more for you than anything else. Do you know what I'm talking about? Y'all understand? If you know what I'm saying, say amen.
Amen.
There you go. Come on. Let's wake up. I know you ain't fell asleep yet. You haven't fallen asleep yet. We're almost there. But like Barnabas, we're talking about Barnabas and Paul in Bible study. Again, the Bible study reference. Wednesday night. About how Barnabas over in Acts 4, he sold his property, gave his money to the church so that they could help spread the gospel. The early church in Jerusalem. That's what he did. He's sacrificial giving, sacrificial service is what it's about. not just giving somebody an extra nickel because you got an extra nickel, but actually giving something that you don't have anything of or don't have a lot of. Mostly it's time. Most of us are pretty blessed people. We are really blessed people, to be honest with you. This is a blessed church. We were able to give a lot more than some churches twice our size. But a lot of times it comes down to time, sacrificial giving of your time. Like when we come out here Friday nights during Turkey Shoot, 3rd of November. It's coming up soon, guys. Turkey Shoot, coming up soon. But that's a Friday night when somebody could be out doing something else. But we're here at church with the people in the community trying to share Jesus with them. That's what it's all about. Jesus tells us that when we serve others, we are in fact serving him. Matthew 25, 35 through 40. For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came to me. Then the righteous will answer him, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? And when did we see you a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? And when did we see you sick or in prison and visit you? And the king will answer them, truly I say to you, as you did it to one of the least of these, my brothers, you did it to me. When we serve others, we are in fact serving God. When we have an opportunity at that point when we're serving others to tell them about Jesus, to evangelize to them, which leads me to my third point. We need to be hungry for evangelism. We have to be hungry for evangelism. 1 Peter 3:15. But in your hearts, honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you. Yet do it with gentleness and respect. Sometimes we leave that last little bit off, gentleness and respect. We try to cram Jesus down somebody's throat, and that's not how it works. We should be bold in our proclamations about Jesus, but we have to do that with gentleness, respect, and gentleness. Compassion. Jesus said, lead with compassion, but flip a table if you have to. He didn't really say that, but he did that. He did that. We tell others about Jesus' love and his grace, his sacrifice for us, his service to us. Tell them about what he did for us, what he did in our lives. I've said this 100 times. That's all right. Get that milk, buddy. Go ahead. You got it. Go ahead, Maverick. Get on that milk. I've said this 100 times, and I'm going to keep saying it until I'm proven otherwise, and I won't be. Your testimony, no matter how big or small it is one of the most powerful things you can ever tell someone about what Jesus has done for you, about what God has done for you, about the change that has been made in your life is your own story. You don't have to have a PhD or a bunch of letters before or after your name. You don't have to be a great orator. You don't have to memorize the Bible backwards and forwards. Just tell them what God has done for you. That's what I do. That's what I try to do. I'm like, we've been in tight spots more than once. And God showed up every single time without fail, whether I was looking for him or not. I could see him afterwards, after I came through that problem. I could go back and see that. That's what we have to tell people. We got to tell them about Jesus. You should have that desire to tell them, that knot in the pit of your stomach that says, you know what, this person needs to hear about Jesus right now. There's something that's missing in their life. I can see it. And then you break out and you go do it. You go talk to them about it. John 14:6 says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. That no one comes to the Father except through me. The only way to salvation is in that verse right there. And there's a lot of folks running around telling other things, saying there's more than one way to Jesus, more than one way to salvation. It's illegal to beat them up, so you can't do that, but you can try to correct them. Like I said before, you have to be bold. You can't be timid when you're talking about Jesus. When Paul wrote his letter to the church in Ephesus, he instructed them to pray for each other, but also to pray for him over in Ephesians 6:19 and 20. And also for me, that words may be given to me in opening my mouth boldly to proclaim the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that I may declare it boldly as I ought to speak. If Paul can pray for bold preaching while he's locked up in prison, we should be able to do that while we're sitting in a pew on Sunday morning, free and clear. Or when we're driving on our way to work, or we're at work. Paul was in prison. We are not, nor are we going to be, more than likely, anytime soon, hopefully, unless y'all have warrants. I'm not aware about But there's nothing keeping us from being bold for Jesus, being bold for God, being hungry for that boldness, except us. I said a couple Sundays ago that the devil doesn't want you to do these things. He doesn't want you to be bold for Christ. He wants you to be timid and scared, running around like a little church mouse. He doesn't want you to be able to stand up in front of people and tell them about what God has done in your life. He doesn't want you to do that. But Jesus told us in the Great Commission over in Mark 16 and 15, he said to them, "Go into all the world and proclaim the gospel to the whole creation." Not just the people you like, but everybody. The whole creation. You got somebody at work you don't like, I ain't going to tell them about Jesus. I don't want them to go to heaven. You don't want to do that. That's not how you're supposed to do it. You got to tell it to everybody. Because that's our job. It's to lead as many people to Christ as we can. Not just my job, but everybody's job. Because if God didn't have a job for us, he'd have called us up to heaven when we got saved. But I'll tell you what's the truth. Now I was thinking about this after I wrote that down, because Ronnie said it several times before as well. If we're in church on Sunday morning and somebody comes down here to the altar and they accept Jesus as their Savior, and all of a sudden they disappear, God calls them up, they go home right then, the church would be pretty empty, I think, because it would scare the mess out of everybody in here. It'd be a hard sell to get somebody to believe in Jesus when, as soon as they believe in Jesus, they disappear. So, anyway, that's a little sidetrack. You're welcome. That's where my brain is. My brain derails all the time. Man, but it's okay. It's going to be all right. So let's recap. When you feed on God's word, you will hunger for service to him through serving others. And when you serve others, you will have the opportunity and the desire to tell them about Jesus. See how we made that big old circle? Then they'll get into the word. Then they'll start serving others. Then they'll want to evangelize the people. And then those people will want to get back into the word. Get that circle going. Get into the word. Help other people when they need it. Tell them about Jesus. Keep that cycle going. You cannot be a true believer in Jesus Christ and sit on your hands all the time. God gave us that desire to please him, which we do through serving others. I'm going to make another shameless plug for our Wednesday night Bible study. If you are not here on Wednesday nights, folks, I'm telling you, it is eye-opening. It is eye-opening. We had a 15-minute diatribe Wednesday night about growth, the growth that we had seen just over the last couple of years of Wednesday night Bible study. There's a lot of times when Ronnie's preaching, I don't get hardly anything out of what he says. I mean, I get the gist of what he's talking about, but I don't get the amount of meat, that milk that I need, except for when I'm here on Wednesday nights, Sunday school. Because we are able to have that two-way conversation with the people. Whoever's standing up here is just, you know, a ringleader. But everybody, it's full-blown conversation coming back. And we talk back and forth across the pews. And the fellowship is fantastic. The growth is exponential. And I get it. Not everybody can be here on Wednesday nights. We have to fight to get here sometimes on Wednesday nights. But when we get here and we do it, it has made such a huge blessing. It made such a huge difference in our lives and the lives of the people who show up faithfully every Wednesday night. Every Wednesday night, same group of people are here. And the longer they come, the more conversation they have, the more questions they ask. And I'm going to attribute it to Ray Sands. Ray's not here, bless him. I know he's got a lot of stuff going on, but Ray Sands is what started all of this. We would be on Wednesday nights. This was before COVID. Wednesday nights and Sunday mornings, he'd be in there asking some of the craziest questions that I'd ever heard anybody ask. But he didn't know. It may not have even been related to what we were talking about, but he wanted to know. He asked the questions. And that actually started the two-way conversations, the back-and-forth conversations that we have in those classes. So God bless you, Ray. Thank you for doing that. That was the Lord doing that through Ray. And Ray, even now, when he comes up in here, he brings up something that he's learned or he's got a question about something. He does the same thing to Victor. That's the kind of growth that I'm talking about. That's the kind of growth that we need to have. We have to have that hunger. Because if we don't have a hunger for God, then he's not going to give us anything. He's not going to supply us with any food. If I go to the house after lunch or after we get done with here and I say, yeah, I'm not really that hungry. My wife's like, okay, we're not going to fix anything for supper. That ain't going to happen, though. Yeah. Somebody in that house is going to eat. I can promise you that. The more we do for others, the more he would do for us. Bottom line. But what I don't want to happen is what happened to the Israelites over in Amos chapter 8, verse 11 through 12. Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord God, when I will send a famine on the land, not a famine of bread nor a thirst of water, but of hearing the words of the Lord. They shall wander from sea to sea, from north to east, and they shall run to and fro to seek the word of the Lord, but they shall not find it. During the Israelites' prosperity, which they had ups and downs, Judges is full of that, but they rejected the prophets. They lost sight of God. They lost sight of what God had done for them. Does that sound familiar to anybody? Can y'all take a look at what's going on outside of these walls right now and see that because of our prosperity, because of the things that we think we have, that we don't need God? We've rejected God and his word. We think we don't need him. We've got it all. We've got everything that we need. And yet we have absolutely nothing. We are penniless spiritually. We don't have anything. There are so many people in this world who are searching for something, but they don't know what that something is. They don't know exactly what it is they're looking for. They know they have something that they need. Because everything they're trying to fill that hole with, it's not working. They forgot who God is, what he has done, and what he continues to do for us. The world is hungry for something, and it's up to us to show them the way to true satisfaction, how to truly be fulfilled. I'm going to leave you with two more verses, John 6 and 37. All that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I will never cast out. So when you lay yourself at the feet of Jesus, when you accept him as your Savior, whenever you plead to give your life to him, he will never cast you out. He will always be with you. He'll always take care of you. All you got to do is call him. You pick up the phone and call him. Get down on your knees and you pray and you call him. And he'll help you. His answer may be no sometimes to your prayers. That doesn't mean he's not answering them. He may answer no because that's the best course of action for you. Because our ways are not his ways. Amen? Thank God for that because, man, I'm going to tell you what. There'd be a lot more destruction around here if our ways were God's ways. If God's ways were our ways, I'll put it that way. I'm going to leave you with one more. John 6 and 44. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up on the last day. So is the Father drawing somebody in here to Jesus this morning? Do you feel that pull? Are you tired of trying to satisfy your hunger with that worldly appetizers? Do you have a desire, do you have a hunger to want to know who God really is? All you got to do is ask. If you have a need this morning, if you want to be truly satisfied, I ask you to come up as we sing our closing song. It is well with my soul. Whew, man. Page 73. If you have a need this morning, I ask you to come on up. We will. 73. Page 73. Y'all stand and sing. Give him a hand this morning. Yeah. Go ahead and have a seat real quick. We're going to have our benediction. Before we do that, we're going to ask Sister Nicole to come up. She's asked to be anointed this morning. Ask the deacons if they would to come forward as well. Come on up, Sister Grace.
Grace is having some issues that we want to pray over, and Nicole has come to stand in for her, even though she's up here. But we are going to take it out because the Lord tells us to go to Him for all our needs. So let us pray.
Amen.
Father, we do thank You for this child of Yours that has come to You with faith in her heart that her child is going to be better. They're going to figure out what's going on. The issues are going to be solved, and she's going to get on with her life so it won't be so disruptive.
Yes,
we appreciate You giving us this opportunity to come to You when we have these needs and to petition You for our needs. Take this child, take her mother and her grandmother, and just lift them up that Your will be done in this situation. We love You, we praise You, and we thank You for Your blessings.
Yes.
In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.
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 Amen. Yep, we're going to go ahead and bless the food before we go in here.
Yep.
Why not? Yeah, might as well. That way, we're going to bless the food.
I want to make a quick announcement.
Go ahead.
We go.
Yep.
Just a quick announcement before we head back there. I have been asked to give a little bit of instruction. We want the more seasoned adults in here to go first.
Well done.
Yep. And what we're going to do is we're going to go into the fellowship hall and hang a left and go towards the stage, and then we're going to come back around to get our food and plates and all that goodies. That way we're not in a traffic jam in the hallway here. We can get people on in there, get them seated where they want to be.
Does that make sense? Take the long way around when you go in there. Take the long way around. It's all good. All hearts and minds are clear this morning. Thank you all for being here. It's always a pleasure to stand up in front of you guys and see all these smiling faces back. I didn't lose too many people this morning. It's okay. It's good. I got to preaching the other day. I think it was only about 5 minutes into the sermon, and I was at another church, and there's three people already asleep before I even got started again. And I was like, well, it's okay. It's going to be all right. But we're going to go ahead and bless the food before we head back. So if you all would please rise. Let us pray. Our most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you again thanking you for the many blessings that you've given to us. We thank you for allowing us to come again into your house, Father, and to hear your word, sing praises to your name, Father. Just be with us all now as we go through to our homecoming dinner. Just we thank you for all the fellowship and the blessings that we're going to receive today, Lord. Just take this food and bless, nourish our bodies and our bodies in thy service. In Christ's name we ask it. Amen.